Phantom Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Star Wars, The Truce at Bakura, by Kathy Tyers. Above a dead world, one habitable moon hung suspended like a cloud-veiled turquoise. The eternal hand that held the chain of its orbit had dusted its velvet backdrop with brilliant stars, and cosmic energies danced on the wrinkles of space-time, singing their timeless music, neither noticing nor caring for the Empire, the Rebel Alliance, or their brief, petty wars. But on that petty, human scale of perspective, a fleet of starships orbited the moon's primary. Carbon streaks scored the sides of several ships. Droids swarmed around some, performing repairs. Metal shards that had been critical spaceship components, and human and alien bodies, orbited with the ships. The battle to destroy Emperor Palpatine's second Death Star had cost the Rebel Alliance heavily. Luke Skywalker hustled across one cruiser's landing bay, red-eyed but still suffused with victory after the Ewok celebration. He ached, a dull gnawing in all his bones from the longest day of his life. Today, no, it was yesterday, he had met the Emperor. Yesterday, he had almost paid with his life for his faith in his father. Yet a passenger sharing his shuttle up to the cruiser from the Ewok village had already asked if Luke had really killed the Emperor and Darth Vader single-handed. Luke wasn't ready to announce the fact that Darth Vader had been Anakin Skywalker, his father. Still, he'd answered firmly, Vader killed Emperor Palpatine. Vader had flung him into the second Death Star's core. Luke would be explaining that for weeks, he guessed. For now, he merely wanted to check on his X-Wing. To his surprise, it was overrun by service crew. Behind and above it, a magna crane lowered R2-D2 into the cylindrical droid socket behind his cockpit. What's up? Luke asked. Oh, sir, answered a khaki-suited crewman, disengaging a collapsible fuel hose. Your relief pilot's going out. Captain Antilles came back on the first shuttle and went out on patrol immediately. He intercepted an Imperial drone ship, one of those antiques they used for carrying messages back before the Clone Wars, incoming from deep space. Incoming? Someone had sent a message to the Emperor. Luke smiled. Guess they haven't heard yet. Wedge wants company? Well, I'm not that tired. I could go. Wedge Antilles had been his friend since the days of the first Death Star, when they'd flown in the final attack together. The crewman didn't smile back. Unfortunately, Captain Antilles touched off a self-destruct cycle while trying to release its message codes. He's manually blocking a critical gap. Cancel the relief pilot, Luke exclaimed. Through the Force, Luke quested outward and found Wedge's presence. His hands moved on the X-Wing's controls almost effortlessly as he steered toward that end of the fleet. Wedge, do you copy? Luke asked over the subspace radio.
Sorry, almost out of range of my ship's pickup. You see, I've got to keep these two crystals apart. It's a self-destruct of some sort.
Crystals?
Electrite crystal leads. The mechanism's trying to push them together. Let them touch. Poof. The whole fusion engine.
Tumbling slowly above the blue glimmer of Endor, Luke spotted Wedge's X-Wing. Alongside it drifted a 9-meter-long cylinder bearing Imperial markings, fully as long as the X-Wing and almost all engine, a type of drone ship the Alliance still couldn't afford. For some reason, the drone filled him with foreboding. The Empire never used such antiques anymore for sending messages. Why hadn't the sender been able to use standard Imperial channels? Wedge clung to one end of the cylinder, connected to the X-Wing by a life support tether. He must have blown his cockpit air and dove for the cylinder's master control the moment he realized he'd accidentally armed it to detonate. Even in his pressure suit and closed-face emergency helmet, he couldn't survive vacuum long. Closing in, Luke reversed engines with care. Wedge held one hand inside a hinged panel. That hand must be half crushed. Luke frowned. Sweat trickled on his forehead. If he didn't hurry, his friend was dead. Already, Wedge's sense in the Force wobbled dizzily. Cautiously, Luke slipped his lightsaber into the flare ejection port's feed tube. He launched it out, then extended a hand toward it across 10 meters of vacuum. He sent it gliding toward Wedge. As it neared the target, he twisted his wrist. The green-white blade appeared, silent in the vacuum of space. Wedge's wide brown eyes blinked inside his faceplate. On my signal, jump free.
Luke, I'll lose fingers.
Way free, Luke repeated. You'll lose more than fingers if you stay there. At moments like these, moisture farming for Uncle Owen back on Tatooine didn't sound too bad. Show me the crystals, said Luke. Look at them closely.
Okay.
Wedge pulled around to stare into the hatchway. Letting the lightsaber drift, Luke felt for Wedge's friendly presence. Through Wedge's eyes and fighting the excruciating pain in Wedge's hand, Luke glimpsed a pair of round, multifaceted jewels, one inside his palm, the other crushing inward at the end of a spring mechanism from the back of his hand. Fist-sized, the jewels reflected pale, golden sparks of saber light out the hatch onto Wedge's orange suit. If Wedge jumped, Luke would have a second at most to slice one crystal free, and only a little longer before Wedge fainted. Jump on the count of three. Jump hard. One, Luke said. Wedge didn't object. Clenching his teeth, Luke eased into a closer accord with the saber. So long as he focused on the saber, he could maintain control. Two, keeping up a steady count, he felt the saber, the crystals, and the critical gap, all as parts of the universe's wholeness. Three. Nothing happened. Jump, Wedge! Weakly, Wedge launched himself. Luke swept in, one crystal soared free, reflecting a whirling green kaleidoscope onto the X-Wing's upper S-foil. Wedge's body rose and sank with each breath as he floated upright in the fleet's clear tank of healing Bacta fluid. Much to Luke's relief, they'd saved all his fingers. A surgical droid named 2-1B had run tests on Luke himself and pronounced a diagnosis of sudden and massive calcification of his structure, of the rare type brought on by severely conductive exposure to electrical and other energy fields. Yesterday, Luke realized, Emperor Palpatine leering as blue-white sparks leapt off his fingertips. Luke had thought he was dying. He was dying. The surgical droid had urged him to rest, but Luke was eager to get to the war room and find out if the drone ship's message had been decoded yet. Besides, his pain had been worse when he'd lost his right hand. Come to think of it, the bionic hand didn't ache. Some bright spot. Large enough to hold 100, the flagship's war room was almost empty. A service droid slid along the curve of an inner bench, passing between a light tube and glimmering white bulkheads. Down near the circular projection table that dominated the war room center, near a single tech on duty, Mon Mothma, the woman who'd founded and who now led the Rebel Alliance, stood with General Crix Medine. Mon Mothma's presence gleamed visibly in her long white robes and invisibly through the Force. And the bearded Medine's confidence had grown since the battle for Endor. They both looked in Luke's direction and frowned. Luke smiled half-heartedly and gripped the handrests of the repulsor chair he'd commandeered out of the medical suite, steering it down the steps toward them.
You'll never learn, will you?
General Medine's frown got flatter.
You belong in sick bay. This time we'll have 2-1B knock you out.
Luke's cheek twitched. Well, what about that message? Some Imperial commander burned 250,000 credits on that antique drone. A small light projection table at the side lit up, and above it appeared a miniature hologram of Admiral Akbar, with huge eyes bulging at the sides of his high-domed ruddy head. Although the Mon Calamarian had commanded the battle for Endor from a chair under the broad starry viewport on Luke's left, Admiral Akbar felt more comfortable on his own cruiser. Life support there was fine-tuned to Calamarian standard.
Commander Skywalker, you need to consider the risks you take more carefully.
I will, Admiral, when I can. R2-D2 wasn't letting Luke out of photoreceptor range for 30 seconds. The blue-domed droid rolled along the upper computer bank to a drop platform. There he downloaded himself, then rolled close to Luke's float chair. R2's rebukes were probably coming straight from 2-1B. General Medine smirked behind his beard. Luke hadn't understood a single whistle, but he could guess. All right, R2, pull in your wheels. Young Lieutenant Matthews straightened up over the side of the console.
Here it comes, he announced.
The decoded message was just coming through.
Imperial Governor Wylik Nereus of the Bakura system to his most excellent Imperial Master, Palpatine. Greetings, in haste.
They hadn't heard. Months, maybe years, would pass before much of the galaxy realized that the Emperor's reign had ended.
Bakura is under attack by an alien invasion force from outside your domain. Urgent, repeat, urgent. Send stormtroopers.
Mon Mothma turned to a shoulder-high droid that stood silently nearby. Access the embedded data files. Apply our most recent Imperial codes. Locate this world, Bakura. Star sparks appeared in a confirmation Luke recognized.
Here, madam,
the droid announced. One speck turned red.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.